they think of you hopping on a train and going up to New York and hanging out at anarchist bookstores on Fourth Avenue and talking to
they didn't mind because
your working class relatives there.
I mean, I don't want to totally trust my childhood memories, obviously, but the family was split up. Like a lot of Jewish families, it went in all sorts of directions. There were sectors that were super orthodox. There were other sectors that were very radical and very assimilated and working class intellectuals. You know. And that's the sector that I naturally gravitated towards. It was a very lively intellectual culture. For one thing, it was a working class culture, had working class values, values of solidarity, socialist values, and so on. There was a sense somehow things were going to get better. An institutional structure was around, the method of fighting, you know, of organizing, of doing things, which had some hope.
And I also had the advantage of having gone to a experimental progressive school, to a Dewey-ite school, which was quite good, run by a university there. And, you know, there was no such thing as competition. There was no such thing as being a good student. I mean, literally, the concept of being a good student didn't even arise until I got to high school. I went to the academic high school and suddenly discovered I'm a good student, you know, which then I hated high school because I had to do all the things you have to do to get into college. But until then, it was kind of a free, pretty open system. And I don't know, there are lots of other things. Well, maybe I was just cantankerous.
As a historian, I have read with interest and amazement your long review article of Gabriel Jackson's Spanish Civil War, and that's a very respectable piece of history, and I can appreciate how much work goes into that.
When did you do that work?
When did you then?
I did that work in the early 1940s when I was about 12 years old. The first article I wrote was right after the fall of Barcelona in the school newspaper. It was a lament about the rise of fascism in 1939. Actually, I guess one of the people who was biggest influence in my life was an uncle who had never gone past fourth grade. He was, you know, had a background in crime, and then left-wing politics and all sorts of things. But he was a hunchback. And as a result, he could get a newsstand in New York. They had some program for people with physical disabilities. And some of you are from New York, I guess. Yeah. Well, you know the 72nd Street kiosk?
Yes.
You know that? Right. That's where I got my political education. At 72nd Street, there's a place where you come out of the subway, and everybody goes towards 72nd Street. And there were two newsstands on that side, which were doing fine. And there's two newsstands on the back. And nobody comes out the back, you know, and that's where his news But it was a very lively place. He was a very bright guy. It was the 30s. There were a lot of emigres, you know, and so on. A lot of people were hanging around there. And in the evenings, especially, it was sort of a literary political salon. You know, every kind of guy is hanging around arguing and talking. And as a kid, like I was 11, 12 years old, the biggest excitement was to work the newsstand.
You write in Manufacturing Consent that it's the primary function of the mass media in the United States to mobilize public support for the special interests that dominate the government and the private sector. What are those interests?
Well, if you want to understand the way any society works, ours or any other, the first place to look is who's in a position to make the decisions that determine the way the society functions. Societies differ, but in ours, the major decisions over what happens in the society, decisions over investment and production and distribution and so on, are in the hands of a relatively concentrated network of major corporations and conglomerates and investment firms and so on. They are also the ones who staff the major executive positions in the government, and they're the ones who own the media, and they're the ones who have to be in a position to make the decisions. They have an overwhelmingly dominant role in the way life happens, you know, what's done in the society. Within the economic system, by law and in principle, they dominate. The control over resources and the need to satisfy their interests imposes very sharp constraints on the political system and the ideological system.
When you talk about manufacturing of consent, whose consent is being manufactured?
We can, to start with, there are two different groups. We can get into more detail. But at the first level of approximation, there's two targets for propaganda. One is what's sometimes called the political class.
there's maybe 20% of the population which is relatively educated, more or less articulate, that plays some kind of role in decision making. They're supposed to sort of participate in social life, either as managers or cultural managers, like, say, teachers and writers and so on. They're supposed to vote. They're supposed to play some role in the way economic and political and cultural life goes on. Now, their consent is crucial. It's one group that has to be deeply indoctrinated. Then there's maybe 80% of the population whose main function is to follow orders and not to think, you know, and not to pay attention to anything. And they're the ones who usually pay the cost.
All right. Professor Chomsky. Noam. You outlined a model with filters that propaganda is sent through on its way to the public. Can you briefly outline those?
It's basically an institutional analysis of the major media, what we call a propaganda model. We're talking primarily about the national media, those media that sort of set a general agenda that others more or less adhere to the extent that they even pay much attention to national or international affairs. Now, the elite media are the sort of the agenda-setting media. That means the New York Times, the Washington Post, the major television channels, and so on. They set the general framework. The local media more or less adapt to their structure.
World News.
In the soundbite, it says that there's a beachhead.
I think
6:28 is a good one.
Yeah, but I think 6 is a good start. This is the operative soundbite for us. He's ours. He really knows how the time is.
He's got a minute for all the time, so that's...
I love this soundbite.
Okay, well,
and they do this in all sorts of ways, by selection of topics, by distribution of concerns, by emphasis and framing of issues, by filtering of information, by bounding of debate within certain limits.
2.5 minutes to air.
No.
45 seconds.
They determine, they select, they shape, they control, they restrict in order to serve the interests of dominant elite groups in the society.
There is an unusual amount of attention focused today on the five nations of Central America.
This is Democracy's Diary. Here for our instruction are triumphs and disasters, the pattern of life's changing fabric. Here is great journalism, a revelation of the past, a guide to the present, and a clue to the future.
The New York Times is certainly the most important newspaper in the United States, and one could argue the most important newspaper in the world. The New York Times plays an enormous role in shaping the perception of the current world on the part of the politically active, educated classes. Also, the New York Times has a special role, and I believe its editors probably feel that they bear a heavy burden, in the sense that the New York Times creates history.
What happened years ago may have a bearing on what happens tomorrow. Millions of clippings are preserved in the Times Library, all indexed for instant use, a priceless archive of events and the men who make them.
That is, history is what appears in the New York Times archives. The place where people will go to find out what happened is the New York Times. Therefore, it's extremely important if history is going to be shaped in an appropriate way that certain things appear, certain things not appear, certain questions be asked, other questions be ignored, and that issues be framed in a particular fashion. Now, in whose interests is the history being so shaped? Well, I think that's not very difficult to answer.
The process by which people make up their minds on this is a much more mysterious process than you would ever guess from reading Manufacturing Consent. There is a saying about legislation that legislation is like making sausage, that the less you know about how it's done, the better for your appetite. The same is true of this business. If you're in a conference in which decisions are being made on what to put on page one or what not, you would get, I think, the impression that important decisions were being made in a flip and frivolous way. But in fact, given the pressures of time to trying to get things out, you resort to a kind of a